Today's episode of the City of Smack podcast on the City of Smack podcast network is presented by Saucony and the limited edition Endorphin Pro Plus. Saucony made waves when they launched the carbon-plated Endorphin Pro racing shoe last summer, and one of the secrets to their success was how closely they worked with their pro athletes to design and develop it. 209 marathoner Jared Ward was deeply involved in the early product trials and testing, and everyone from Jared to Parker Stinson and Laura Thwaite set personal best wearing the final product. But the thing about pro athletes is that they're never really satisfied. You can give them the latest and greatest gear, but they're always dreaming about what's next. They're looking for whatever can get them a little faster, a little bit more efficient on race day. So when their athletes started testing the Endorphin Pro 2, they told Saucony that they loved it, but they wanted an even lighter version. Something with the same incredible pop and propulsion, but with an ultralight upper. A shoe purely meant for going all out on race day. So the Saucony team went to work, stripping away anything that wasn't essential and swapping out materials for lighter, smoother, and more breathable ones. They obsessed over every swatch and stitch, cutting weight as they went. The result is the Endorphin Pro Plus, a shoe that's tailored for speed. With Saucony's super responsive Power Run PB foam and their signature S-curve carbon fiber plate, it's no wonder that this shoe has been making waves all over the Sneaker Watch Instagram accounts. So mark your calendars for September 28th when you can snag a pair of the limited edition Endorphin Pro Plus on Saucony.com. It is super limited. You'll also get to see the shoes in action at a special test event taking place in Germany on September 22nd. Which you'll be able to watch live on the City of Smack YouTube channel, and it'll feature commentary by me and Kyle Merber. We're getting your favorite announcing duo back together. And until then, check out Saucony's current lineup, including the Endorphin Pro 2 and the Endorphin Speed 2, another plate fan favorite for speed and tempo runs. Thanks to the support over on Patreon, and a special thanks to Travis Downen for joining the Supporters Club on there. Your dollars help us pay our new podcast producer, Mike, who's been crushing it in his first month on the job. The funds also go towards planning for major events coming up, like our fall marathon coverage. I'll be in Chicago and New York. And then the big year will obviously be 2022 with USA's, and then the World Championships in Eugene, Oregon. So if you enjoy what we're doing, support us over at patreon.com/citysmag. You can also make a one-time donation by sending any dollar amount that you feel comfortable with over to City of Smag on Venmo. Shout out to Jake Willard, who just paid us $28.50 because he sent a little message that said, I just completed a 2,850-mile solo road trip and spent countless hours catching up on the pod. Thanks for keeping me company on the drive. Thanks so much for listening, Jake. Another way you can also show your love is by picking up a t-shirt or sweater over at cityofsmag.com and hitting the merch tab. We surpassed 1,000 reviews on Apple Podcasts, and this helps us populate onto people's feeds as a recommended show on Apple Podcasts. And it allows possible sponsors to see what listeners think of the show and then could invest in City of Smag. So it all helps. It goes a long way. And it takes just a minute to leave a review and rating. So I greatly appreciate it if you can do so. Thanks again to everyone who has taken the time to do so. My guest for today's episode is Jared Ward, and I believe this is his third time on the show. His first appearance was in February 2019, and then he was on last fall before he ran in the London Marathon. Now he's back as he gets ready for the New York City Marathon and will also be running in the Saucony Future Fast 10K in Germany, which you can watch next Wednesday at 2 p.m. Eastern Time on the City of Smag YouTube channel. Jared has raced pretty sparingly since he competed at the Marathon Project last December, so we get his details on that now that he's worked his way back into shape after taking some time to help his wife with their new baby. We also get his big goals for this fall, which include a podium at the New York City Marathon. Wouldn't it be too crazy? And I also appreciated this episode a lot because Jared and I talk about what coming back has felt like for so many people during this pandemic. I recently posted to Twitter and Instagram about how I was initially planning to go to the Chicago Marathon and try and break 3 hours, but I'm just not quite there yet. I had to be really honest with my body. I'm still shaking off the pandemic rust. So if you're one of those people who's been hoping to get back into that string of hitting PRs, and sometimes training's going right, but the results aren't showing immediately, I'm right there with you, and Jared's got some good advice. So without further ado, here is Jared Ward. All right, now we welcome back Jared Ward to the podcast. I think this might be your third appearance on the City of Smack podcast. So a nice recurring guest. People always seem to love to have you on. The last time we spoke was before you went out and ran the London Marathon. It's the interview that led to the mantra, don't get laughed, and you didn't get laughed. You ran 212 in those cold and rainy conditions and held off anyone from you know, laughing you on that course. So mission accomplished, and welcome back, Jared Ward.
Hey, thanks, Chris. It's good to be back. And yeah, don't get lapped.
I guess let's catch up, I guess, what the past couple, almost year has been like for you. You've raced pretty sparingly, I would say, within the past couple months, a couple 10Ks on the road, but not too much else. So what have you been up to this entire time?
Well, after London, I came back and ran the Marathon Project like weeks later. And after the Marathon Project, I swore to myself that I would not run another marathon until I was ready, like fully trained to run it. And also that I wouldn't commit to another race until I was pretty sure that it was going to happen. You know, I know that this wasn't just me. I assume there's a lot of us that can relate to this, but it's tough to navigating through the COVID months and now years of, hey, I'm training hard for a race and then it gets canceled or delayed, or, you know, or I'm not training and then there's an opportunity for a race. So we just jump at everything we have. It wore on me. And so I just kind of, after the Marathon Project in December, I really took 2 or 3 months of very, very light training. It was the most significant running break I've taken since I was a sophomore in high school outside of serving a mission for my church. And so, you know, coming back from that now, like I'm finding that I've still got work on getting my mind back to where I want it, and I've got work on getting back physically to where I want it. And I think it was a good break for me in a lot of ways. And we had a baby, and so there's other stuff going on at home, and it was good to be a more active part of that. But I just keep telling myself to be patient, and I think it'll come back.
I feel like it's because of the mustache, the kids, and just, I guess, how long you were in school that people might feel that you're older than 32. And so you sound like one of those grizzled vets who just took their first long break at like 37 or something like that. But I guess, like, what did recharging those batteries do for you, I guess, in those, you know, 3 months of softer training, I would say?
It was good for me to focus on some other things. I think I was so fit going into the 2020 trials, and the race just didn't go well for whatever reason. It's almost like throwing darts at the wall as to what the real reason was. But I was disappointed, and then, you know, kind of bounced back from that with some fire for these fall marathons, London and Marathon Project. And then when they didn't go how I had hoped for, I was just really leveled mentally and emotionally, and I think even physically. That 2020, as funny as it sounds, because I know all the marathons were canceled, 2020 was the first year of my life that I'd run 3 marathons in the same year. And I was just shot in a lot of ways. And so I do feel like I got some good time to recharge the batteries, but it's almost like now the batteries are recharged, I got to remember how to use them. And that's a little bit of what I'm feeling. Like, you know, I just got back from New Haven, we were running like marathon pace for the first 6 or 7 miles in this 20K tune-up race. And I just kept thinking, you know, mile 5, mile 6, mile 7. I was like, is this how I felt 6 years ago when I won this race? Because I don't feel very good right now. And, you know, we forget how we feel, like the acute sense of feeling, we really forget. And I think that's why you hit the finish line of a race and we can just be happy with whatever the result is because it's over. And then, like, you know, we're laying in bed that night and we're like, man, why didn't I run faster? Why didn't I do this different? Or why didn't I train different? Or, you know, but in the moment, it's tough. You know, it's the same reason, you know, we have five kids. If my wife could remember labor, every single one, we'd have one kid. And so, yet I think there's something to, you know, we forget that. And so I'm in the middle of these races thinking, man, did I just forget how to, like, turn on my racing switch and say, hey, it's time to go? Or do I just have a little bit more fitness to gain back? Because I've had some good workouts, but not as much volume and not as much consistent volume and maybe not as consistent of workouts. And so, you know, I think I've got some fitness to get back, and I got to be fit enough to then be able to kind of work on my mind to get my mind back. And so I think the break was a blessing, but it was a long enough break that there's some things that I got to get back now.
I feel like you're preaching to the choir here, because it's something that I'm totally feeling right now in sort of like this marathon buildup. At first I was thinking of chasing a personal best at the Chicago Marathon and going after, I've run 3:06. I was like, it'd be nice to break 3 again. But then I go on some of these long runs, or, you know, it's probably like 15 or something miles. And I just think it's hard. How did I like sustain, you know, a minute faster than this pace during a full on race effort at half marathon? And I sort of do feel like the pandemic rust is real, and it's going to take getting back into those race environments a couple times in order to completely shake it off and then finally start to think, all right, I can, you know, gear back up and try and go after personal bests again. And so but part of it too in the process is trying to let go of those comparisons in the moment, right? Like, and I feel like it's something in the middle of a race you're also trying to subside.
Always. And, you know, and we talk about the seasoned veterans in our sport, and that's what they preach over and over and over again. The longer you run, the more and more you have to be careful, because, you know, it's not apples to apples when you're comparing a build, even to the same marathon. And, you know, and you know, we talked off camera a little bit about 2018, when I had pulled my hamstring and then was kind of coming back from it and then re-aggravated it in September before New York. And I just thought, man, there's no way that this marathon is going to go well. And I even, you know, I called up David Monty and said, hey, I got to pull out of New York. I just, you know, my hamstring's just not acting up, and I think it's healthy, but I'm not going to be ready in time. And he said, well, just come and run, even if you only run half. And I was kind of like, well, okay, like I can come run half and we'll see how it feels. And I just ran the whole marathon thinking, okay, let's just see one more mile. And it was like I was running the whole marathon with this free dropout pass. And it made it, in some ways, it made it easier to just lay it on the line a little bit more, because I was like, well, if I make it to mile 17, but then I feel like dropping out, I'll just drop out then. I get to mile 17, and I'd be like, well, maybe one more mile. And I ended up having a great race. I finished 6th. And if I had compared that build to even New York the year before, when I think I finished 12th and ran 6 minutes slower or something like that, I would have been like, oh no, I'm not even in that kind of shape, and that's not where I want to be for this race. And so you just never know. And I think there's a lot of moving pieces. We quantify, I'm a scientist, we try to quantify as much as we can, but there's just a lot of moving pieces and a lot of correlations going on, and there's lifetime fitness that we forget about and probably don't give as much weight to as we should. And so I think that advice from some of these vets to just be patient, let the fitness come, let it come back. It'll come back if you're patient. If you're not patient, then you risk injury, you risk burnout, but if you can be consistent, you can be patient, then that fitness will come back. And maybe at the end of the day, we'll surprise ourselves with that lifetime fitness that still hasn't gone anywhere.
That's why, to the point when you brought up the New Haven race this past weekend, while maybe it wasn't the best result on paper for you, a friend of mine texted me and says, well, if you kind of look at, you know, the number of buildups that Jarrett has gone through, not everything has been a home run. And so yesterday was actually a good race for Jarrett in a buildup, and he's probably going to win New York.
Well, I'll take it. I'll take it. And if it works out, I'm going to be calling you and your friend up on the podium with me in Central Park.
So why'd you end up choosing New York? Is it also because a course like that does favor, you know, kind of that getting back into it thing where it's pure racing as opposed to Chicago, knowing that you'd be signing up for something super fast from the get-go?
Yeah, I think that that's true. I think I also wanted the time, you know, New York's a little bit later, but I love New York. I love racing on those streets. And my first experience in New York was as like a marshal in the lead vehicle, just watching the race from the truck. And that was awesome, but I've run it three times. And so this will be my fourth time, and I think I'm figuring out the course. And so I'm excited to be on a course that I feel like I know. You know, there's downhill miles late in the New York City Marathon that if your legs are ready for those, you can really almost hit the reset button every couple of minutes on another little downhill stretch, whether it's in Central Park or as we're getting closer to it. And I think I'm learning just how to lay myself out a little thinner on the line in the New York City Marathon and still be able to make it to the finish. And so I'm very, very motivated by that. But, you know, and it's true that I've had training buildups for marathons that haven't gone as well as this one, certainly tune-up races that haven't gone as well as New Haven. But you still want the confidence that comes from big, good races and big, good workouts. And it, like, you know, I guess I want to point out that while I'm, you know, relaying the advice to be patient, just like I've been given advice from Meb and Ritz and Ryan Hall and Dina and Dez to be patient, it's still hard to be patient. Like you want to see the good tune-up races and the good workouts, because, you know, I want to go to New York. I don't want to go to New York and be, you know, in the pack at 15 miles and then there's a strong move and I run smart. And then I pick off a few guys over the last few miles of the race and I finish 5th to 10th. Like I've done that, and I know how to do that, but I want to be fit enough that I can cover a 440 mile going up First Avenue, and I can sit on that pack and I can be in that race. And that's what motivates me. And so I guess I just want to say, hey, you know, I'm talking myself off the ledge too. I'm telling myself to be patient too, because I'm not where I want to be. And, you know, we're 8 weeks from race day, and so I'm feeling anxious to get there.
How do you practice something like that? I guess having, you know, getting ready for that, dropping a 440 20 miles into a race, like, is that something that in the middle of a long run you implement a workout at the tail end of it to have that, sharpen that speed, so that when a move is sort of made like that, you know that you've kind of done this before?
Yes, I think there's some specific stuff you can do like that. And I do love race pace miles at the end of a marathon, or at the end of a long run, a few. So whether that's running 4 or 5 or 6 miles at marathon pace straight, or whether that's doing some alternating miles where you hit a mile at marathon pace and then you slow down, and throwing in a few that are faster occasionally, or even a fast 800 in the middle of a mile, just to simulate kind of that surging feeling, and, you know, showing yourself that you can settle back into a pace and calm down, and it's okay, even if, you know, because that pace happens and you think, oh no, I can't do this, and then you slow back down and think, oh no, I can do this, like the body's amazing. But I also think that sometimes we feel like we have to simulate things exactly as they are in a race, and there's some merit to just the bulk of marathon training. And this, you know, this is me you know, relaying some inner coach ice stone when I'll say something like that to coach, hey coach, how do we get ready to cover a 440 mile on First Avenue, you know, in that noise tunnel when someone gets excited and they push the pace? And, you know, coach ice stone will say, Jared, just get really, really fit and you'll be fine. And that's really, and I think, you know, we do want some marathon pace miles and some fast marathon pace miles in a long run, but I think there's truth to the reality of just get fit, just get sharp. And that comes from your mileage. That comes from consistent mileage. It comes from staying healthy. Maybe some of it comes from cross training and, or lifting. And I think, you know, to a certain extent, training is training, regardless of the course that you're running on and where you're at. And we'll do a few things to simulate New York, but for the most part, I'll just be training. And if I can get better training, jumping in with the BYU guys, with Clayton, and running with Connor Mance and Casey Klinger and these guys, then Brandon Garnica and Aiden Troutner, then I'm going to jump in that workout and it's going to be a 10K cross country workout, but it's going to lead to fitness. And I think Coach Istone has shown me that maybe I need to worry sometimes less about the minutiae and more about just getting fit, having fun in the process. And I think overall fitness will hopefully help prepare me for that.
So what does Coach Istone say when you go up to him and bring up just the fact like, oh, Bekele's in the race as well? Now, it's sort of interesting because you don't know which version of him you're going to get. He's been very hit or miss in these marathons. And so you could end up getting the version of he's the guy who makes the big move on First Avenue, or he's the one who's just kind of, I guess, by Bekele standards, out of shape and are going to stay, like, I guess, closer to the chase pack, and you wonder what he's going to do and what kind of shape he's in. So you really don't know what you have on your hands to worry about here. But bringing someone up like him to Coach Istone, and I'm sure it's been very similar when you've approached the Olympic marathon and you know you're going to have to go up against Eliud Kipchoge. And so what does Coach say when you do size up the field in that way?
Well, you know, he's very good at phrasing it like an opportunity. You know, say, hey, what an opportunity to race a guy like Kenenisa Bekele. And, you know, he's running Berlin and then he's coming back and running New York, you know, at least on paper as it is now. And so, you know, we don't really, you know, it's tough to plan on what we're going to get. And like you say, and maybe we'll know a little bit more as we get closer to the race. But, you know, we also have the half marathon world record holder, and we have a former world champion and New York marathon champion, and we've got some good people in this race. And as we go down the line of names, you know, Coach is going to phrase it as an opportunity. What an opportunity to race these guys. And you know, you might just be right in there with them. And then we'll have a plan. You know, hey, if someone goes off hammering crazy, then, you know, we need to have kind of a red line governor that says, hey, at this point, you know, we got to be smart. And I think realistic goals help with that too. I think a realistic goal for me, a realistic stretch goal, is to say, hey, I want to finish on the podium. I've wanted the podium for a long time. And it's certainly a lofty goal, but that's going to be my goal going in. And Coach Istone is going to say, okay, to preserve the goal of making it on the podium, we can't throw all caution to the wind covering a move to win the race. And so, you know, podium means first through third, and Coach is always going to keep, you know, he's going to frame it such that, hey, you know, we're going to be in the best position we can be so that you could win if the race plays itself out that way. But he's going to have some guidance in terms of if this, then we're going to do this. If this, then we're going to do this, and listen to your body and listen to your heart. And so, you know, if Bekele starts dropping 430s on First Avenue and he starts stringing them together, then Bekele is going to be by himself. Well, at least Bekele is going to be without Jared Ward in not too much time. Okay. But hopefully that means I'm running 450s and I'm keeping them kind of in the crosshairs up ahead. And I'm hoping to bring it in smart, and that it's more of a, you know, I'm racing to the finish line. And I think that's what I want to be. I want New York to be a race where I'm racing to the finish line more than I've almost popped, but I've done a good job at damage control. And so I'm going to get to the line in reasonable position, right? I want to race to the finish line. And so if that means fifth, but I've raced to the finish line, then that's fine. But I just don't want, you know, I don't want to be in the race and think, okay, you know, the writing's on the wall. I better rein it in a little bit and just be smart. I want to be there.
This sounds like a totally different Jared Ward as opposed to the more statistics based, like mathematical, you know, kind of, you know, calibrating things as you go along in the middle of the race. And so I like this.
Well, so I was like an old wise runner in my younger years, and now I'm getting careless. Is that what you're telling me?
in a nicer way. A quick break now to tell you a little bit about a new sponsor behind the podcast. It's Hustle Clean. You might remember them from when they helped sponsor some of the races and even the drone during the Trials of Miles qualifier series. Hustle Clean is a mission-driven self-care brand for the active lifestyle. It was created by athletes for high performers that want to do more and be more without compromise. The Hustle Clean body wipe is an extra large, durable, full body wipe designed to remove sweat, dirt, and body odor in moments when a shower is optimal but not possible. Their products are safe on sensitive skin, hypoallergenic, paraben-free, and infused with aloe vera, vitamin E, and witch hazel. Personally, I've loved using their lavender-scented one. I carry them in my bag for after my runs because we've all been in these situations. You finish a long run or a workout in the summer and the fall, and you want to meet your friends for brunch or dinner afterward, and you just don't have the time for a shower, you don't have the ability to get to one, the Hustle Clean body wipe holds you over. Get rid of that sweat, get yourself smelling good, toss on a t-shirt, and you're good to go. Hustle Clean is sold nationwide in Walmart, Target, and Amazon. City of Smack podcast listeners, listen up. Get a deal and save 10% off all of their products when you visit HustleClean.com and use code Sidious at checkout. That's C-I-T-I-U-S when you visit HustleClean.com. I want to go back a couple years, and if you remember when you were kind of coming out of college, it was very similar to the fact, like, because of your success in the 10K, on the track, and even the 5K, the people did look at you and said, like, that down the road, he's going to be a great marathoner. And sizing up the battle for top American, you've got someone like Ben True coming into this, making his marathon debut. And I feel like that conversation has surrounded him as well over the past couple of years. He's run a solid half marathon, but now you got to see him in action this past weekend. Have you always felt sort of similarly, I guess, about someone like Ben also possibly being a good marathoner someday?
Yeah, for sure. For sure. And, you know, and it's, you never know until someone runs a marathon, because there's so much, it's just so different in a number of ways. You're using different energy systems. And so a half marathon is significantly more like a 10K than a half marathon is like a marathon. So, you know, I think sometimes we watch someone like a Ben True, they run great 5Ks, they run great 10Ks, they jump up, they run a great half marathon. And then we tend to think, well, half marathon kind of halfway in between marathon and 10K, but really in terms of energy systems, in terms of training, in terms of all this kind of stuff, it's closer to a 10K. That said, Ben True looked really good, you know, at the New Haven road race, we're coming off this tune-up, and he looked smooth at that marathon pace. And he's, you know, he's a Nordic skier at his core. And so he's got some of that going for him. And he is tough. He's just a really, really tough competitor. He's someone that, I have loved to watch run for my entire career. Even when I'm in the race with him, I loved watching Ben True, and have looked to him for, you know, for what he's doing and for advice. And it's going to be fun to be on the start line with him for his first marathon. And I think I'm just as excited as the rest of the running world to see what Ben can do and how he can prep for for New York and come off of it. But he's running really well right now, and he's just a hard guy to bet against in general. So, yeah. So why bet against him? Just bet for him.
All right. So one other point to kind of your experience in the marathon, and particularly in New York, is that I guess since the Super Shoe kind of era really took off in 2016, these marathons that you've run in different iterations of Saucony's edition of the Super Shoe, the Endorphin Pro over the past couple of years. And in the behind the scenes story of that shoe, you played an integral role since its inception as to kind of finding, you know, the competitor to and doing as best of a job as possible to keep you guys in this arms race that's happening on people's feet. And so now you're going to run this one in the Endorphin Pro Plus. What can you tell us about, I guess, about the evolution of the shoe over the years and how we got to this point and what makes this one different than the previous iterations?
So the Pro went through, you know, 20 to 30 prototypes, looking across different types of foams, different stack heights, different stiffnesses of plates, different shapes of the shoe. And one thing that I think that Saucony did really, really well when they launched the Pro is they launched a really refined product, and it was an arms race. And so I think for a while we saw products being released that were just, hey, we got to get something out there, so get it out there. And you know, and something is probably better than nothing in terms of, you know, in terms of marketing and athletes and whatever for across all shoe brands. But Saucony had been working on this product even before the Vaporfly was dropped, in terms of foam that returns more energy, and in terms of how are we going to shape the shoe. And so I feel like Saucony was in a good position already to be ready to compete and create shoes that people can run well in. But once we got that dialed in and experimented with foams and things, then they released a shoe that I was really happy with and excited about, and ran some good marathons in. Now, Pro Plus is taking that shoe and figuring out ways to make it sleeker, lighter, feel faster, be a little bit more assertive. So what I see in the Pro Plus is a version of, you know, what you've seen with the Saucony Pro and the Pro 2.0, but something that is lighter and feels faster. And it's an exciting shoe, and it's pretty cool looking. Like they created a really, you know, when Saucony dropped the Pro, the original Pro in that mutant color, I was like, this is a really cool shoe. Like they really, I feel like, had dialed in an awesome style. The Pro Plus is clean.
It's yeah, just I think it's all white right now, right?
Yeah, it's clean. And it looks good. Feels like you're pulling on a spike for the roads.
Really? Okay. That's a cool way of describing it. I guess how far in advance, how long have you been testing this shoe out?
Not too long. Like I think I got my first Pro Plus like mid-August, maybe early August. And so, you know, I've just done a few work, and they really refine. I wasn't part of the testing as they built this shoe. I think they did a lot of stuff in the lab, and then they just sent it out and said, hey, here's the shoe, test it out. And fortunately, I love it.
Nice. Where do you think things go? It's always interesting to from here with this arms race. Like at this point, like we're starting to veer towards that equilibrium type of part of the whole thing, where now everyone seems to have hit, like, all right, everyone's got their shoe, and it seems to get a little bit more even. But where, how much longer do you think this goes before we finally feel like we're at an even playing field?
I think that there's going to be a few more things in shoe innovation. So I think what you know, in my feeling, Nike sort of flipped the industry on its side when for decades what we were doing to make shoes faster was make them lighter. We make them lighter, we make them more minimal. And, you know, you shave off a little rubber, and then you shave off a little of the midsole, and then you make the upper lighter, and, you know, and then you go through another iteration and you just make it lighter. You know, and the Saucony Type A is the flat. You know, I ran marathons in that flat. It's a very minimalist flat, but it's a light shoe and it's a fast shoe. I was tired after the marathon, you know, my legs were shot after the marathon, but I ran some good marathons in the Type A. I ran in Rio in the Type A, but that was the game for so long. And now industry flipped on its side. Huge things are foam, carbon fiber, stiffness. And then I think everyone taking their own twist on shape of the shoe and certainly different foams and things like that. But what, you know, what Nike, one thing that Nike did was it just kind of kicked over the industry for a second and we're rebuilding. So eventually we're going to rebuild and it's going to converge on, you know, whatever it is. But I think there's some more rebuilding. I think we're going to see some cool, novel innovations to shoes for a few more years. You know, some stuff that isn't just low density foam that returns energy with, you know, I think we're going to see some cool stuff. And frankly, I just got a box of, the next version, you know, prototypes from Saucony and they got some cool stuff going on in there too, it's different. And so, I think there's more to come and we've got testing and that's exciting to me. But we want the fairness for the pro athletes. We want some sort of equilibrium, right? But we also want a competitive system that creates good, fast products for everybody. And we want to be able to run healthy for a long time. And I think one of the untold stories that's a result of this new version of, I'm going to call them a class of super shoes, is that I can run a marathon and recover faster. I think these shoes added 2 years to my career because I'm beating up my body a little bit less every time I go on an all-out effort. And so I'm grateful for that. And I think I'll be healthier for it. And hopefully runners everywhere will be. And so I think there's things to be applauded, especially as we look at just overall health and longevity and lifetime fitness and activity. And anyway, so that's a longer answer than you wanted, Chris, but that's where my thoughts are.
No, I think there just needs to be a shoe that kind of puts an end to it. Abdi doesn't need to make a sixth Olympic team and extends his shelf life even longer.
Abdi, man, I've never met a guy that looks so bad when he walks and can still run so fast.
I think I've observed that before from him and it's so accurate.
I'll say like, well, I'll be in New York with Abdi and they'll be like, hey, do you want to ride back to the hotel or you guys just want to walk? And he'll be like, nah, man, I'm going to walk. And I'll be like, Abdi, dude, I'll walk with you, but you've got to walk, man. I'm not going to take 2 hours to get from the run center back to the hotel. We got to go. And he'll be like, man, I can walk. You know, I love Abdi. My kids love Abdi. I think everybody loves Abdi, but you're right. You know, he's obviously responding well to his shoes and who knows? He was telling me last time I talked to him, he's like, well, after they made the 2020 Olympics in 2021, I started thinking, it's like 2 years till the next trials. Like, yeah, man, you're not going anywhere.
you've nailed down the impression too. That is spot on.
he is one of my, you know, he's one of the funnest people to be around in this sport. You know, he's so laid back. He's so individual. He's unique. Man, I love being around Abdi.
So between now and New York, we've got this trip to Germany that's coming up. 10K road race on, like, I believe it's like a Criterion course. It'll be looped, and they're testing out wave lights on the course as well. I don't know. You just made a face. You didn't hear about that before, right?
No, you're telling me new stuff, man. You know, yes. More. You know,
they
might know more about this than me, but I'm glad we're both out there together.
Yeah. So they're going to try and, I guess, like to add to the whole innovation part of the sport, a road race with the same wave light technology that we're seeing on the track. So that should be interesting because I guess you haven't been back on the track since they started implementing that, right?
No. Yeah. It's cool.
Yeah. Well, when is the decision not to run the track trials?
Oh, so we had our fifth baby in April. And at that point I was still thinking, yeah, I'm going to hop on the track. And then about 4 weeks after we had James, I thought, I think I'm just going to be patient.
Yeah.
And I'd had some good track work, but I don't think enough to where I guess I like to think that I could have made it to the trials had I got into the right race. And, but it, you know, it would have taken, you know, would have taken a miracle for the trials to have panned out in a way that I'd have really been excited about it. And so I just decided to cut my losses, wait till 2024.
I think that's when I realized it's like some of these marathoners, unless Galen was still kind of in the mix, but you had to be able to close in under 55 for that last lap.
Yeah.
And sometimes you've let that ship sail.
Right. Well, and I think I'd have been excited to be at the trials in the 10K contending for the team with two laps to go, even if I got dropped on that nasty kick that all those guys have these days, because I'm not kicking like that. I think I'd have still been excited to be like in the top 10 in the hunt with a few laps to go. That would have been worth it to me for the experience. But even that was going to be tough, I think, given where I was at and the quality of depth at the trials. So anyway.
So now we've got the test event in Germany. It'll be kind of what, just a little bit of a, you know, tune up, see if you can, you know, mix it up with Parker and some of these other guys for a little bit.
Yeah. These guys from my era, you know, I've raced Parker and Brian for, I don't know, a decade, a long time. So yeah, it's fun to run with those guys. Brian was in New Haven. I think Parker's in DC, and so anyway, we all have some other tune-up stuff going on, and then this will be my last race before New York, so kind of a final test, and it'll be fun to see Germany. I've never been to Germany before.
Really?
One of my best friends from high school married a girl in Europe, and they live out in Germany, and so after the race I'm going to go down and visit them, and I'm pretty excited about this whole trip.
Yeah, that's awesome. Kyle and I are making it like a 48-hour trip, so we'll be in and out. I'm glad to hear that you get to enjoy it.
Just a little bit, yeah. It's still kind of quick, but it'll be good.
All right, so next couple of weeks, what is it exactly? We're looking at Don't Get Lapped was the motto for London. You can't get lapped on the New York City Marathon course, so we're thinking best-case scenario podium. What needs to happen between now and these 8 weeks ahead of us that really kind of you dial into to try and, you know, kind of make that, you know, the goal for the race?
You know, the mantra that I've settled on is trust. I want to trust myself. I want to trust my system, and I want to trust my coach. I want to trust my training partners, and just, trust the goals that I had for myself 3 and 4 and 5 years ago that the pandemic has just tried to beat out of me, every way it can. I want to trust. And I think that means go up to, for me directly, that means volume. I haven't been up to marathon volume yet. I've pushed some okay volume, but really second half of this week starts volume. And so I'm going to be pushing volume and then pushing volume through the end of September and volume through October. And I'm just going to trust the system. I'm going to try to be patient and let that fitness come.
So you're rocking the beard right now, and then eventually it shaves down to the mustache for the marathon?
I think so. I think that's the plan.
Gotcha. All right, Jared. Well, I appreciate you taking the time for this. It's always a blast to catch up, and I'll see you in Germany in a couple weeks.
Hey, man. Thanks for everything you do for the sport. You broadcast it so well. We're grateful to have Chris Chavez in the sport.
The City of Smack podcast is a production of the City of Smack Podcast Network. It is produced and edited by Mike Zerzolo. Did you enjoy this episode enough to dish out a couple bucks? Support City of Smag by pledging any dollar amount over on patreon.com/cityofsmag to join our loyal legion of backers who keep this show going strong. If you're on your phone right now, you can also open up the Venmo app and hit us with a one-time donation to @cityofsmag. We've also got merch over on cityofsmag.com. Any way you can show your support goes a long way. Thanks for listening. I've been your host, Chris Chavez, wishing you some happy and healthy running. Legs are feeling good. See you next time.